Welcome everyone to Kiss Meets the Podcast, episode number 6. I'm Eli Clausen.
And I'm Branton.
And I'm Chad.
And this week we are going to discuss a what-if scenario. But first, we're going to just touch on a few other things. Some recent history anniversaries. I'll let you guys take that.
Well, I'll just say yesterday in history, one of my favorite Kiss albums was released, Music from the Elder.
Very cool.
So that was yesterday.
That was in 81, so what?
81.
35 years now.
Yeah.
Wow.
That's crazy.
It is crazy.
I believe, wasn't it today that's the anniversary of Rock and Roll All Over?
Yes, it is. 40 years.
Wow.
Insane.
Same age as I am.
Wow. Yeah. One of my favorite albums. It's hard to pick a favorite song off that album, too.
Yeah, every one of them is really good.
By the way, our local radio station, WTUE, they have a thing every Saturday night. It's called Long Kiss Goodnight. And it runs for, about an hour, hour and a half, and they play nothing but Kiss and all kinds of cuts. Cool. And they were playing some tracks from Rock and Roll Over last week. I was listening to it on the way home from the show. Just thought I'd throw that in there. Little plug for WTUE 104.7. Check it out.
Are they on iHeartRadio? Because, I can pick up stations on that from...
Yes, actually, they are. Yeah.
Cool, I'll have to check that out tonight. Then I can put on my phone and check it out. So
yeah, Saturday night around... Yes, I'd say around maybe 11:30 our time. That's about when they usually do it, so... They play all kinds of cuts, man. It's not all the...
It's a good station, because I grew up listening to that station.
Yeah.
Is it a normally just a rock station, or how does that... Is it an independent station?
It's classic rock. And
okay, cool.
Yeah. But, so, of course, at this point, the Kiss Cruise is already come and gone. I was pretty happy with the set list, to be honest, for the, the Creature show. Was a little disappointed that they played the same exact set the second night. I figured they could have changed it up, done some other Creatures cuts and whatnot. But, I am happy with some of the surprises they did pull out. Some solo album cuts and all that stuff to go along with it. So what'd you guys think about the set?
I liked it. I thought it was a pretty good list in general. And then the stage and the costumes looked good. That was pretty cool. I would like to have been on the cruise, to be honest with you.
Yeah. Well, they already announced next year's cruise.
We may have to get tickets for that because, like you said, they played the same set list two nights in a row, but if I was on the cruise, I would definitely see it two nights in a row.
Oh, yeah. Don't get me wrong. I'd have been there both nights, too, but at the same time, it's kind of I kind of would have figured. But anyway. But, yeah, they already announced next year Kiss Cruise 7. This time it's taken off from New Orleans instead of Miami, so that's kind of interesting.
Be cool if you're closer to me. That's only about... 8 hours from me or so? Not a bad drive.
Yeah, I didn't think that they would... Unfortunately, I didn't think that they would play the full Creatures album. I was just hoping they would.
Yeah.
Like I said, I don't know if I said this on the air last time. I was hoping that they would not play the songs they normally do from that album in concert, but they did.
True.
Yeah.
And I know that they would, play those because they're more familiar with those. It's probably easier to do that.
I agree.
But yeah, as far as them doing... the songs that they did do, I think Keep Me Coming, they used to do on that, was it the Creatures tour or the Lick It Up tour, they used to do that song.
Lick It Up was the last time, I believe.
And then I don't think they've ever done Rock and Roll Hell. Have they ever done that one?
No. And let alone, Wouldn't You Like to Know Me?
Yeah, that was a really good version of that. I think that was great. It's strange to see the whole band singing in the background in that song. It was really cool.
I love that they brought back Radioactive. That's my favorite track off Gene's solo album. I love that
song. Another good one, yeah.
But again, I understand, doing the I Love It Loud, if they did those both nights, but I really wanted to hear Saint and Sinner, man. It's at least they could have switched a few of those up. Saint and Sinner. Even I Still Love You. You figured they probably would have done that, but oh well. Overall, it was definitely killer. There's a lot of video clips out now of those performances. So, very cool.
I think that if you see the Eric's costume, it was sort of similar to Eric Carr. You know, it had like the V going down with the same belt and stuff. But it just, I don't know, man, with the makeup and stuff, it's like, ah. I knew it wasn't going to be anything different than that because they'd already said.
Well, did you notice his drums were kind of similar to Eric's too? That silver, metallic, you know, with the double bass, and you know, I think we were pretty much right when it came to Tommy. He was wearing that, you know, lightning bolt suit.
That was sort of strange too, because only outfits or the only time Ace wore that is when they were just doing those public appearances for the album for the Elder.
Right.
He never did any concerts when that outfit, he was gone by then. So that was sort of odd to see that. I mean, it was great, but I don't know. Maybe I'm too much of a stickler for accuracy, you know?
Yeah.
I mean, I would have, in a perfect world, I would have liked to seen, you know, okay, you're Vinny and you're Eric Carr, you know? I don't know. I think that would have been cooler, but that's just me.
I don't know.
I think
if Eric Carr were still alive and not in the band, then you would have seen Eric Singer as Eric Carr or as the Fox. I mean, but I don't know. To me, it would have a really weird vibe being that Eric's not here anymore.
And I can understand Paul and Gene's feelings behind that.
Yeah.
And I think out of respect to Eric Carr is the reason they didn't do it. And if I was in their shoes, I would probably, you know, feel the same way.
Right.
But from a fan's perspective, or at least from my fan's perspective, I don't know. I just think it's just makeup, really. So, you know, I sort of look at it both ways. But
when it comes to Vinny, I think they're just trying to pretty much forget that he was ever in the band and write him off, you know, as the years go by more and more. So, like, don't even acknowledge him. And
you know, I was thinking, too, about Tommy wearing the outfit he wore. I think hasn't he wore every outfit that Ace wore except for the Dynasty one now?
He hasn't worn the Love Gun. He hasn't worn Love Gun or the one from the Hotter Than Hell.
Oh, with the V with the circles going around it.
Yeah.
Yeah, because they didn't go back that far, did they?
No.
They went back to the Alive album, and that was it. Or Dress to Kill, I guess it could have been.
Other than that, I think... No, he hasn't worn the Destroyer one either.
Actually, there's quite a few I don't think he's worn, actually, now that we think about
it. Really? I was thinking that he's worn all of them, but maybe not.
Well, I don't know, I guess...
Because he did the... I think he did... Was it Destroyer?
Well, the one he normally wears now is... based off the Destroyer, but it's not quite the same. I mean,
because I think when he first replaced Ace, that was, what were they wearing then?
That was
for Symphony, Kiss Symphony,
right around Symphony. They were wearing those reproduction Alive costumes. So when he first came in, he was wearing the one that I think it had like the round silver, you know, those things on it. And I don't know, man, if he ever did wear the Dynasty costume, I think that's where I would finally draw the line, because to me that's a little too much, because that's one of my favorite Ace costumes, and
I can't see them even going there.
I kind of hope they don't,
just in general, because I don't think they're proud of that for some reason. I mean, I can understand, you know, you've heard some things they've said about it. And same thing with, like, Asylum and all that. You know, I can't see them doing – I personally would like it, but it'd be a little bit hokey, I think.
I mean, for all we know, next year's cruise, they could end up doing a Dynasty show or go back to, like, the Hotter Than Hell costumes or something. But
if anybody can talk Paul and Gene into it, it'd be Tommy and Eric.
Right. Yeah. And is there a reason they're doing it from New Orleans this time? Because, you know, those Dynasty costumes are sort of Mardi Gras-esque, if you kind of think about it, you know.
That's true.
Could that be sort of a little reason why? I don't know. Probably not, but just throwing it out there.
You never know.
Right. They always surprise us one way or another.
Well, they if anybody wants to sponsor us, we would love to be on that cruise right now. So, we'll just PM us and we'll give you our addresses to send us money.
We'll start saving pennies right now.
Yeah, exactly.
That's and about maybe, all I can say.
Just maybe Vinnie Vincent might be on this cruise. So. You know, people always give him a hard time. But, you know, he really is a talented guitar player, and I dig him. I mean, you know, whatever. But I like him.
His playing was good, but it comes down
to... I don't think he's saying Kiss as much as... You know.
Well, yeah, for one, he was trying to do his own thing on the solos and not even try to honor what Ace did. So that was kind of a... But at the same time, it was one of those things where he pretty much shot himself in the foot and ruined his own legacy because of being so hard to work with and, you know, filing lawsuits and all that kind of stuff. He pretty much wrote himself out of history.
It's kind of a shame, though.
In my opinion. But.
Yeah.
So,
Vinny, come out of hiding. Come out. Come play somewhere.
Come out and play.
Come out and play.
When he was in the band... Correct me if I'm wrong, but I know when they got Bruce, it was like this. But when they got Vinny, I think it was just because he was already familiar with him from the songwriting aspect. He happened to be a guitar player. But it seems like from that point on, they always wanted the guitar player that had a popular style for that time period.
Yeah.
And I wonder if that's another reason that they chose Vinny, you know, other than the fact they knew him.
That, and they probably... figured he was already seasoned enough as far as touring from some of the bands and things that he was in before.
That's true.
Then they probably realized, okay, we gotta, you know, maybe test these guys a little harder, and, you know, but then of course, look who came after him and how long that person lasted. So,
yeah.
So, I mean, that may have just been because of a medical thing, which you can't help. So who knows how much longer.
I guess he was like a real like showman guy. Mark St. John was like a real showman. So I'm not saying that's bad because that's sort of what Paul and Gene are. You know, they consider themselves entertainers.
Yeah, I mean, you know, if you watch, I think it's the Heavens on Fire video that Mark's in, and he's doing a couple, you know, flashy things like, you know, playing the fret like this. Yeah, and,
right.
You know, he was doing, but. Had the health issue never came up, who knows how long he may have been in the band. Who, you know, maybe there would have ever been a Bruce Kulick. I don't know.
Yeah.
What if?
Yeah, what if? And that segues right into our topic for this week. Oh, man. We're not going to talk any Slipknot. We're going to talk Kiss right now. So I'm gonna turn the microphone over to Brent. Now we're let Where's Brent handle this. Brent came up with this idea. It's a great idea, so we're gonna have fun with this and roll with it. So I'll let Brent explain what the topic is, and we'll get into it.
Well, I don't even know what made me think of it initially, but you know, when you're a Kiss fan, you think of all the what ifs scenarios. You know how it would change the course of. The way the band went as far as, you know, recording and touring and costumes and so on. So, initially Paul Stanley and Gene Simmons met in 1968, you know, did the Wicked Lester thing for a while, then went on to form Kiss in 73 is when they got started. But I thought, okay, and this is with Ace and Peter, of course. And I thought, well, what if they had met in 78 instead of 68? And started Kiss in 83 instead of 73 with Tommy and Eric. Because a lot of people, you know, not so much now. I mean, there's still fans out there that, you know, they're divided on how they feel about the current lineup as opposed to other lineups, whatever. But what if this was the original lineup? And they're, you know, started in 83 to the present. That changes pretty much everything.
Just to clarify real quick for the people listening, Eric Singer, correct?
Eric Singer.
All right, just wanted to clarify.
Okay. Yeah, Eric Singer.
But, yeah, very. that's a very interesting subject.
Chronologically, you can start off with 83 with the first album. The reason I say that is just because what Kiss was doing in 73, 74, put that in the time period of 83, what was going on in music at that time. And to make things even more complicated, because Kiss had influenced a lot of those bands that were around in 83, and saying they just got started instead of the 70s, what would music be like? Would those bands even be around? Or, you know what I mean? It's so complicated.
Wow.
I don't even know where to start on that. But, you know, if you think about, you know, you think about, okay, so their first album comes out in 83. That's the kind of the beginning area of the hair metal or glam metal, whatever, however you want to describe that, depending on who, how you like that. So you got bands like Motley Crue coming out. I don't know, your Bon Jovi's, your Poison and stuff. So would they be playing the music they're playing? Because Kiss, you know, Kiss influenced them from the beginning, you know, back in the day. So right. Kind of makes you wonder, would Kiss be influencing them, or would these bands be influencing Kiss?
Hey, it's funny because if they started with their first album in 83, like Def Leppard, Pyromania was like the biggest selling album in 83, one of them. It's almost like thinking about the songs that Kiss did on the first album and then knowing the truth and thinking about what they did on Lick It Up in 83, it's not the same Kiss. So right. You put the first album next to, say, Pyromania. I mean, it's almost like that they would have been aliens like they were in 73 when they started with what music, like, I don't know, what was popular in 73? I can't think of anything specifically.
I wasn't born yet, so I don't know.
Yeah, I mean, I don't know exactly what they were competing with there. I don't think there was a competition. There was nothing really to... I mean, Sabbath and Zeppelin, that was probably it, really. Right. It was, you know, big bands.
Right, New York Dolls, stuff like that.
Yeah. So, you know, in 83, if they sounded like they did on the first album where the first album came out, it's almost like they would be looked at as like, what in the world are these guys doing?
Exactly. But
at the same time, would Motley Crue look like Motley Crue did in 83 on the Shout at the Devil album?
True.
Because I mean, Nikki Sixx says we're not influenced by Kiss. We're more influenced by Alice Cooper and, you know, punk and stuff. I sort of believe that. I sort of don't.
Yeah, and I'm not going bold.
No. Well, I mean, if you look at Nikki's, some of the outfits he had on with the shoulder pads and all the other stuff, it has a Kiss, whether he admits it or not, it has the Kiss influence on that. I mean, whether he
And yeah. Stage show, too. I mean, a lot of those bands with their stage show.
Oh yeah, with the pyro and the logo in the background lit up and that kind of stuff. So,
you know, I find that really interesting about would those bands have been influenced? I think we would have probably never even seen the hair metal, glam metal phase, because Kiss is pretty much what influenced that, and then It just evolved into, you know, they were wearing makeup, but not to the point that, you know, Kiss was, obviously. So I think that whole phase would have never happened, and maybe rock would have just stayed at that kind of, you know, like that 70s sound, like the kind of, you know, grungy, heavy.
Like maybe type. Judas Priest, Iron Maiden.
That's what I'm saying. Yeah. Yeah, Judas Priest, and even Def Leppard, they didn't really wear makeup necessarily, so right. You didn't really, you know. It was more of a dirtier look, I guess, not such a pretty boy look. You know,
you know something else. Stuff. I agree with the glam thing. I don't think it would have been there at all. And something else, if you're into black metal at all, you know that a lot of black metal artists were influenced by Gene Simmons with the makeup, blood, and the fire breathing and all that. So a lot of the first wave of black metal, that's what they were doing because they grew up on Kiss. That was an influence.
Exactly. Right.
And Gene mainly. You're so, right. I mean, maybe black metal wouldn't have even existed, or at least with that part of it, it wouldn't. With
that
the corpse,
is, that is
they
true. Call
it corpse pain and stuff.
You know, so, I think, like, going back, you know, Kiss themselves, I don't think they'd have been nearly as big of a band as what they are, you know, now, the way history went.
I agree.
If they started in 83, they would have just kind of been just another band, you know, just like a lot of these other bands that are, you know, they're well-known, they've got some hits, but not, you know, as iconic and, you know, as Kiss is now, as we know Kiss.
Well, and I think you'd see him playing. You might still see him playing, but they'd be playing small venues like a lot of the bands from that era. You know, I've seen, you know, Faster Pussycat lately, LA Guns, those kind of bands. They're playing in, you know, like the club I saw them in, it was like 100, 200 people. You know, it wasn't like it was a stadium. You know, Kiss now is still selling out huge stadiums, you know.
Yes. And another reason I don't think they would be anywhere near, because they wouldn't have Bill LaCoin back in them, because at that point he would have already had another cash cow way before them.
Yeah,
he wouldn't have nothing to do with them, nor, you know, there would have been no Sean Delaney, none of that stuff.
There would have been no Casablanca Records either.
No Casablanca.
Well, yeah, that's exactly.
So, you know, they could have just been on, say, Epic Polygram. Or something. Or, yeah, Polygram. And they would have just floated, and they'd have probably been an opening band for longer than what they were, you know, originally. And still, they wouldn't have been anywhere near, you know, and obviously we wouldn't have all this merchandise and
right.
memorabilia.
That was all in. Exactly, yeah.
You know, Tommy and Eric being in the band from the get-go, there would be no Black and Blue, there would be no Badlands, there'd be no, you know, him playing, Eric Singer playing with Alice Cooper and Lita Ford and Black Sabbath and some of the bands he's played with. So their career would have been a totally different, too.
Yeah,
compared to his reality.
Maybe Kiss to this present day would still be all four original members. Maybe there would have never been any breakups and tension in the band and solo albums and all that. You know, maybe they would have been one of those bands that, you know, lasted throughout all the years.
So say they started in 83 with the first album, you know, as with Eric and Tommy. Okay. So then they go through their progression chronologically. You know, Hotter Than Hell, Dressed to Kill. They do the live album, you know. So when they get to the solo album period, you know, the initial reason they did the solo albums was to keep the band together, more or less, right?
Right.
Right.
So if that was not an issue, would they still have done the solo albums? Just, hey, let's just do this. It's a cool idea. We'll sell more records, whatever. Or you think they would have just not done that at all and went straight into the next studio album? I wonder how that would have went.
I don't think they would have done the solo albums, to be honest.
I don't either. And there definitely wouldn't have been no Kiss Meets the Phantom of the Park.
That's true. There wouldn't. That's true.
Because they wouldn't have been that type of commercial machine. So it's like, why would they do the movie?
So Dynasty would probably have been a lot different.
True.
Yeah.
Because I think between 79 and 82, they were trying to figure out what to do to sell records and how they wanted to present themselves image-wise. And I think that I don't think that period would have been the same if they'd, you know, I don't know. It's hard to speculate what it would be like. It's almost like the way I would see it is like, and of course there's no right or wrong to this, it's like AC/DC makes the same album every time, more or less. It's the same thing. But I think Kiss would have probably sort of done that too, potentially, you know, because they wouldn't have had a reason to try to do all this other stuff because they wouldn't have been losing members. You know, and I'm just basing it on the fact that Tommy and Eric's been in the band for X amount of years, I think longer than Ace and Peter originally was in the band. Is that true? Or at least one or
pretty
both?
Close.
Yeah, I know, especially with Tommy. Because it's been, what?
Since?
What year was Symphony 03?
03, 04, or something like that.
So we're at 2016 almost, or almost 2017, so yeah.
So he's been in the band officially for, you know, a good 13, 14 years.
Mm-hmm.
And
yeah.
Ace lasted, what, maybe about eight, nine years?
81, 82.
Yeah, originally, so. And then on the second run, he only lasted, what, maybe 6 years?
Yeah.
So, but I think as far as with the Dynasty thing, I think the music would have been different at the time because they'd have still been on that roll, you know, putting out gargantuan albums and the heavier type music. that they wouldn't have had to be at that point where they felt like they had to fit into what was popular at the time, at least, you know, at least for one or maybe two songs on the album, just to get some sales and help out. And, you know, without going that sort of disco route, which ended up turning a lot of fans off, and it did kind of make them more of a family band, if, you know, some might say, you know, because you started seeing a lot more kids showing up to the shows, and, you know, they knew something was going on, and it was kind of the wrong thing, but eventually they embraced it, of course. But
well, they were still making huge amounts of money, so it's hard to turn away families when you're making, you know,
right,
huge amounts of money and doing what you're doing. So,
well, that's what Paul Stanley said about writing "I Was Made for Loving You." He used to go to Studio 54, and he said, "I can write this stuff in my sleep."
Yeah,
you know, and he proved that he could, you know. but it's funny because I don't know how many albums that would have been, like from 74 to 79, and this gets really ridiculously complicated. Okay, so we're saying that we're going to leave out the solo albums. So that, do you count that as four albums, technically?
Technically, yeah, I'd say four.
So I'm trying to wrap my head around the time frame of when a Dynasty album would have came out.
I mean, technically, there are four separate records, but they were all released on the same day, so I kind of look at it as one release.
Right. Okay, so 83 would be the first album, and they were doing two albums per year there for almost all of the 70s up until 79.
Mm-hmm.
So I'm just trying to speculate in my mind. It's too much math for me to think about. But so you have 74, then you have Hotter Than Hell, you have Dressed to Kill, you have Alive. Then you go into Destroyer, and you have Rock and Roll Over, Love Gun, and then skip the solo albums, and you go to Dynasty. So I'm trying to think how many years that was.
That
so
would have been,
where would that put us in the 80s, or would that even be in the 90s by now?
Well, that would have been, it would have been about a two-year gap, because between Love Gun and Alive 2, and then Dynasty was 79.
Yeah.
So
yeah, double platinum, but that was 78, right?
Right. Yeah.
Because I guess you could count double platinum, since it's nothing off the solo albums.
Because even in the 80s, they were still putting at least once a year. It seemed like every year there, up until maybe 89 was kind of when they stopped, maybe. But I would, as far
see, I'm trying to count the albums. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5. See, I should have wrote all this down. I can't.
And you're counting the Alive albums, right?
Yeah, I'd say probably the Alive and Double Platinum. So I'm just sort of curious what year Dynasty would have came out if they started in 83 chronologically. Just to get a speculation of what the music was like in with other bands at the time.
Well,
it would be almost to what, 89?
It would have been
91. 91,
okay.
So 91, that's right before Nirvana.
Could you imagine? Right.
Wow, that would have been crazy.
So if they're putting out something, well, you know, I think we've established that it probably wouldn't be like Nirvana. It wouldn't be like Dynasty is, based on they wouldn't have had to do a lot of the solo albums and all that.
True.
So it would just be like a straightforward Kiss record, more or less.
Right, so I picture it being a hybrid of Creatures, Lick It Up, Animalize,
so
like
kind of. 91, that would have been... That would have been better for them in 91 in a way, but they would probably, would they be considered dinosaurs at that point?
Well, you know, a lot of bands, I mean, that really changed that, you know, when Nirvana came out, was it 92, 91, 92?
Yeah, anything that was before that was just like,
You think of all those bands from the 80s and stuff, they decide, it's like they didn't even exist anymore once Nirvana hit, and that whole sound, grunge or whatever you want to call it. And I don't think they would have it. I don't think Kiss would have had the impact in 91, 92. That, you know.
Because they weren't really selling a lot of records at that point in real life, in reality. Because wasn't it, what tour would that have originally been? Like Revenge? Hot in the Shade?
Hot in the Shade, but maybe?
They wasn't really filling up arenas then, is that correct?
Right. Yeah, this sounds ridiculous to say, but maybe when Nirvana came out and changed everything, that would have killed Kiss's career too, just like it did all those other bands.
It very well could have.
That sounds, it feels weird to even say
it
that.
It very well could have. Because look at all the other bands, they had to just, they broke up and just got day jobs.
Yep.
Just and then, or whatever, because they couldn't sell anything.
Exactly. And they,
until about how many years later they are on the, like, nostalgia.
Exactly, yeah. The whole nostalgia. And Kiss
would have probably been doing the same thing.
Yeah. I mean, I don't know. I mean, again, this, it feels weird to say, but it's almost like that's kind of what they are doing, is the nostalgia
right
thing at the same time. I mean, it's
right.
It's still fresh and new. They're coming up with new ideas.
And, you know, that's something else I just thought of. If they started in 83, they would have never taken the makeup off. They wouldn't have had to. If they got to 91, say with something that's called Dynasty, but is like more of a Kiss album, a regular rock album, would they have taken the makeup off then? And then, or, you know, like when they originally took it off, well, let's get to 83. What year would that be? Or I mean, like, Lick It Up. So you got Dynasty.
If all four original members were still in the group to this point that we're talking, I don't think they would have taken the makeup off. So I know that had to be one of the big factors.
Yeah.
Because they started getting all these different members. And then, you know, like they've said hundreds of times, it's, you know, what's next, Dog Boy and Giraffe Boy, you know, all that. So it kind of became more of a, it didn't really come from the heart on the characters. It was more just like, oh, what would you look cool as? And
right.
So, but okay. If we were still all four original members at this point, then I don't think the makeup would have come off.
Probably not.
So let's say we're at 91 right now. We still got the makeup on.
Yeah.
Okay, so you got that going on. You got Nirvana and Soundgarden, these bands coming out. Do you not think that people would think they were a joke now at this point because they're 91, they celebrate the makeup, because nobody's really doing that, you know? You know what I'm saying? I mean, I don't mean that in a negative way because I'm a huge fan, but you know what I'm saying? I mean,
right.
People might have thought, you know, that new generation coming up, you know, listening to Nirvana and that kind of stuff, would they look at Kiss in 91 and go, or 92 and go, what are these guys doing? You know,
they would almost be clumped into, like, with hair metal and stuff.
Well, that's what I'm saying. And so it makes you wonder if that would have even been relevant. And also, if you think about it, if they start in 83, would they have ever put the makeup on to start with? Let's say they never put the makeup on to start with.
That's a good point.
It's very possible that could have been.
Because if they came out at the same time as all these other bands, you know, they might have worn the eyeliner and that kind of stuff, but not the full-on Kiss makeup may not have even existed. You know what I'm saying? They may not have even...
And there might not have been other bands today like we have, you know, that carry the theatrical stuff like Ghost and Lordy and some of those other bands.
Exactly. Well, even like you were saying with the black metal bands, where they painted their face in the corpse paint with the white and, you know, black, because a lot of those bands, if you look at it, it's taken from Gene. Even King Diamond, you know, at one point had to make up almost exactly like Gene. And so, you know, like I said, you know, he was influenced from Kiss.
Well, see, you know, and that's what I've said all along to people that's not fans of Kiss. They've influenced everybody.
Right.
Oh, yeah.
You know, from the beginning till now. And you can ask any band member if they're honest with themselves. And I've heard a lot of people say in interviews, you know, it's like, yeah, you know, I listened to Kiss. I had Kiss albums, my brother's Kiss albums, you know, listened to them dressed up like Kiss on Halloween. You know, everyone says that, like Alice in Chains and a lot of those bands, you know, were influenced by Kiss. And I think Nirvana even covered Do You Love Me on a compilation.
Mm-hmm.
So, I mean, it's crazy.
Well, like a record collecting documentary I was just watching the other day, I don't know how many of those people. First record I ever bought was Destroyer. First record Alive. Yeah. You know that. I don't know how many of those people on there were talking Kiss was their first record, and you hear that from so many people and musicians.
And like you said, they influenced so many people. I mean, everything from, you know, the hair stuff from the '80s, and you look at all the bands like Pantera and all these other bands that are really heavy.
Oh yeah, dude.
they're all influenced by Kiss. I mean, even have like the Melvins who did a cover album, you know, of Kiss songs.
You know, and it even crosses over into country. I remember seeing Rascal Flatts when they first was coming out, and they had like flames on the stage and stuff. You know, it's like that's directly from Kiss. One Direction did that. I mean, everybody you can think of has theatrical stuff, and, you know, it's all from Kiss.
Well, what's her name? Was it Taylor Swift? Didn't she come out as Kiss, like her and her band? Like,
they seems like I heard something about that.
They did it on a concert. They were doing it to prank whoever they were on tour with or something. I could have sworn.
Oh, okay.
Something to that effect. But, you know, even Slipknot, they were influenced by Kiss. So, you know, all that theatrical, the pyro, all that stuff. I mean,
well, and that's the truth, because really, I don't think when they started in the 70s, Kiss, there was nobody doing all that stuff, I don't really think. I don't think you really saw the cool lights and some smoke, but all the explosions and then the logo in the background, you know, lit up and all that kind of stuff. That's, and even their stage, you know, how they'd come up and, you know, Ace and Apology, you know, they come up on the riser things. I mean, you didn't see that.
Yeah, and it's like you said, in the 80s, everyone had a logo behind them, behind the drum riser.
Yeah.
Well, drum risers too. Everyone had a drum riser.
Right.
And it was all about how bombastic you can be. And
they invented all of that stuff.
Right.
I mean, anybody out there watching this that might not be a Kiss fan, just look at the history or the Kistery.
Yeah.
Okay, so now going back to 1983, so there had to be, I wonder if, there would have to be another band that probably would have come up with that stuff. You know, you'd have to have, you know.
Right, well,
so
if Kiss had the makeup, they wouldn't have influenced anyone. And if they, or, I mean, I don't know if they could have, because it took a certain amount of years for the next generation or whatever to come up, like with hair metal, to be influenced. So you have to have that gestation period for, like, if Kiss started in 83 looking like they did in 74 or in 73, whatever, then you have that time period. But time, what is that, like 10 years? You ever take 8 to 10 years? Mm-hmm. So you fast forward to from 83 to, that'd be like 93, just say. Right. Then, you know, those bands as popular in 93 would have been influenced by Kiss as opposed to years earlier. So what was popular? I mean, by that time, you still had a lot of the grunge bands. And then you had the second, sort of the second generation, not had started yet, of grunge, like grunge light, they called it, or new metal. Some people call it new metal, which is like Linkin Park and some of that stuff. So, and those bands in reality say they're related or they were influenced by Kiss. You know, like Tom Morello from Rage Against the Machine. He's a massive Kiss fan. He helped them get in the Rock and Roll Hall of Fame. If it wasn't for him, I don't think they would have been in there, among a lot of other people that probably helped.
Yeah, his speech when he inducted them was
awesome. Oh, that was awesome.
I got goosebumps, man.
That was awesome. Yeah. That was the best ever.
Yeah. Touching a little bit about the makeup, I really don't think, had they had come out with the makeup on in 83, it would have worked at all. And, you know, it was so different, you know, from 83 compared to 73. And that's why it worked, because, you know, like we were saying, there wasn't really anything like that out there at the time. It was different. That's what got people looking at them. And,
well, Gene said that the only competition was like John Denver.
Right. Yes. And, you know, basically the Dolls and Alice Cooper, and that was really about it. I mean, and in those days, that was what was going to get attention, is you look different versus today, you know, how different,
you know,
it is.
And it's funny, though, the thing that kills me is, okay, you compare the reality to this what-if scenario, and a lot of people... I'm sure there's still a pretty, you know, good percentage out there. Maybe not as many as there was X amount of years ago, but a lot of people will still think that, you know, Kiss, like before they took their makeup off the first time, is a joke band, and you know, Paul said they were listening with their eyes, not their ears, and all this. So that's when they started in 74. It was that's the way it was. So if they started in 83 or 73 to 83, it would have almost been the same thing. It's like, oh, they're a joke band. You know, look at these guys. You know, we need to tease our hair up and wear eyeliner, and they're wearing like all this makeup that looks like, you know, monsters or whatever, you know. So I think they would have still been looked at the same way that many years later if they had started, which is, I don't even know how to feel about that.
I agree. I mean, because even to this day, you still get people that think, oh, they're a joke, and, you know, they're wearing all, you know, they, I don't understand how it's like people get a mental block because they see the visual, and then it's like all of a sudden they don't hear the music or let themselves hear the music, which is what really counts to, you know, and when it all comes down to it, it's like, no, this is how they look. They suck.
Right.
How can you?
If they suck so bad, I mean, they've been around over 40 years. So, right. I mean, there's something they're doing right. I mean, you know.
I mean, they've got, what, second only to the Beatles in the amount of gold albums in, you know, America. And I mean,
that's a major accomplishment.
And yes. They sold out the Budokan two nights, which the Beatles didn't even do that. So, you know, and I'm not sitting here trying to compare old Kiss is better than Beatles or vice versa, because, you know, they're both huge in their own ways, but.
Right.
It's, I just don't understand. Well,
there's like Zeppelin, for example. You know, Paul Stanley's a big, that's one of his major influences, Zeppelin. You hear him talk about that and stuff. But Zeppelin's looked at completely different than Kiss.
Mm-hmm.
Because they, I don't know, would you say they really had an image? You know, back then in 69 when they started. They were just doing blues and just sort of cranking it a little faster, a little louder.
I mean, to me, Zeppelin's just always been a plain regular band. I mean, yeah, they're great musicians. That's why they're as big as they are. But there was really no image. And
that's what I said. There's not really an image to them. I mean,
do you think that is the reason that they're looked at completely different, because they didn't have a look?
Yeah, I think it's because they were just that kind of. You know, they all, well, not all Americans, they're all British, but
it's funny though.
They were that plain.
Regular guys.
Yeah, they were just the regular guys out there playing music. And
if you watch The Song Remains the Same, that outfit that Jimmy Page is wearing, it's that black satin, and it has like moons and stars and planets all over it. And I think about Ace Frehley when I see that. It's like, that's a spaceman outfit. To a certain degree, you know what I mean?
Yeah.
And back then, it's almost like, I mean, people don't talk about that now. I mean, I am talking about it, but it's not like, oh, well, you know, Robert Plant had these hip huggers on where you could see what religion he is. You know? And he's wearing these blouses. It looks like women's blouses and stuff.
Yeah.
But they weren't doing that for an image, or were they? Because this was 72, 73 at Madison Square Garden, isn't that where that's filmed at, I think?
Yeah. I mean, you could say there's definitely a bit of an image to an extent.
I think that was just them being themselves to a point, too.
Because a lot of it back then, too, was about wearing the tight pants, you know, like you said, to see what, but that was what got the attention of the girls. And,
right.
And maybe some AC/DC people out there, too. But other than that, I mean, it's like, I feel like that's why they get the attention of being the best rock and roll band ever, which, you know, is very, very highly arguable, in my opinion. But
I agree on that. I think it just depends on the person, though. I mean, that's –
But if Kiss, well, if Kiss had come out – It's
Zeppelin. You hear that all the time.
Right. But if Kiss had come out and they were just – and that's why they did what they did, because they didn't want to be – another plain Jane bunch of guys just standing up there in jeans and flannel shirts and looking down at their instruments. And, you know, that's why they did what they did.
That's what separated them too. You look at all these bands that were doing that with just, you know, street clothes, you know, like some jeans and a t-shirt. Well, then here comes Kiss and leather and makeup and, explosions. I mean, that they got people. It did. It got people's attention. Whether you liked them or not, it got your attention. You knew who they were.
It's like they said, they wanted to be the band they've never seen or that they wanted to see. And
yeah,
if nobody else is doing what you want to see, then why not do it yourself? And that's what they did.
Well, I've heard interviews where Ace has said that, you know, in the very beginning, well, Paul said this too, as far as, you know, there's people laughing at him and stuff. And but by the end of the concert, you know, everybody's just going, they've never seen anything. What was it that Gene or someone said that, you know, even if you hate the band, you still have to admit it's the best show you've ever seen.
Right.
Right. And that's the truth. I mean, you know, that's, and the thing is, they were a household name, whether you liked them or not. Everybody, there was nobody in the 70s who didn't know who Kiss was. You know, my parents were not fans, but they knew who Kiss was. You had to know who they were. So.
Exactly. I mean, it attests, you know, even up to the recent tour and concert, there's a lot of people there that I knew of personally that had never seen them before and or maybe weren't the biggest fan, but they left that show saying that that was the coolest thing I've ever seen. And, you know, it, every time I see them, it's the same way. It's like it's better every time.
And that's a great thing because, you know, you hate nothing's worse than spending money on a concert ticket and you're like, really? This is what I paid for? You know, especially the cost of concert tickets now. Tickets have gone way up, and, you know, I expect a good show. You know, you want to see.
Yeah.
You want to see them play good, but you want to see all the theatrics go with it, and that makes a great show. I mean, it's.
Yeah, you don't want to see them just standing there, standing still, playing their instrument, you know, lip syncing. You know, if you want to do that, just stay home and listen to the damn album. It's...
That's what I was going to say. Just listen to your music at home.
Right.
But, you know, the show is an experience. You want to go away going. Has such awesome memories that, you know, and talk about that to your kids, your grandkids, whatever. Oh, you know, I saw this band and they were amazing, you know, and it's just.
Right. I mean, 40 plus years later, they're still making sure that everyone feels like they get their money's worth. And they don't have to at this point. They don't have to put that much care and effort into it, but they do. And it's like they.
And to me, this is a lot about the band, too, right there. Whether you like them or not, if they're willing to do 110% every night, that's pretty impressive, you know. That's.
It's like, you know, Gene likes to say it a lot, you know, we're the bosses, you know, when it comes to the fans, you know, they wouldn't be where they're at without all of us. And, you know, I think a lot of us probably wouldn't be where we're at without Kiss because, you know, how much they mean to a lot of us and, you know.
Well, and like we've said in previous podcasts, if it wasn't for Kiss, we might not even be any of the music we're listening to now. I mean, you know, Kiss was a lot of our beginning points. And, you know, from Kiss, we moved on to all this other stuff. And, you know, that's how we kind of evolved. And, you know, they're kind of like a gateway, kind of like a gateway drug. You know, you start a little Kiss, and the next thing you know, you're, you know, you experience all this other stuff. It opens your eyes up to all this other stuff that's out there.
I'd have probably been a, you know, diehard Beatles fan or something because that's kind of what I was listening to growing up before I got introduced to Kiss. And, you know, yeah, I still love the Beatles. They're right, you know, right there with Kiss, and I listen to them a lot still, but I, you know, if Kiss had not been around, then I'd probably have been that diehard Beatles fan that likes everything Beatles. And drink break.
Well, I was going to say something about, let me think, I lost my train of thought here. As far as, you know how it is now on the Kiss cruise and people talking about set lists and stuff when Kiss goes on tour. You know, if our scenario was true and they started with Tommy and Eric in 83 and they were still with them, would all this be a big deal and would it matter? Because if Tommy and Eric had been in the band originally, they wouldn't have been fans of the band like they are. Like, you know, as real people, like they are. So they would be on the same level as Paul and Gene or as Ace and Peter was in that way. So they wouldn't have been trying to push for obscure songs or this or that, whatever. So would that be a good thing?
Yeah, I'd like to think that maybe a lot of those songs would be considered obscure today because they'd have been playing them throughout all the years because as much as Eric and Tommy, we know, like to try to push those type of songs, I could see you know, all through them years, like, hey, let's do this on this tour. And,
do you think that they do that because they were fans? Like, now in real life, they do that because they were fans of the band first?
I think a lot of it's that, and just to, because they know that the fans would like to hear that kind of stuff. They have that different perspective versus how Gene and Paul look at it. But
I think they look at it as, you know, as fans too. If they were at the show, they weren't in the band, they were at the show, what cool song or obscure song you might want to hear thrown in there, you know?
Right.
Just like any fan would. You like to, it's always cool to hear like a deep track or whatever thrown in the middle of all the, you know,
I just think that, and I can't speak for myself, but it seems like just being a fan of music, and I'll use Kiss as the example because, you know, that's who we're talking about. If you've noticed how Kiss has, like, and a lot of bands I'm sure do the same thing, they'll go up and down in their career, and I don't mean in, like, record sales, but as far as, like, you know, when they first started out, you know, they're a specific type of band. They're really hungry. They want this. They'll do anything. And then they start selling records, and then they get a little bit like, okay, well, we're going to try this experiment, and we'll do this and try to sound different, and we're going to look different, and we're not putting as much effort into it, blah, blah, blah. You know, because, I mean, you know, in the 80s, of course, Hal Jean sort of off trying to be an actor and stuff. So it just seems like, and then around Revenge, Gene's completely back. You know, he's like full on Kiss and nothing else. And then once they get to Psycho Circus around that area, it's sort of like, and Paul even said someone said it's like they're Vegas, you know, which they said that about Dynasty too. If you look at the Psycho Circus tour, there's a lot of colored lights, and there's a lot, I mean, more than usual, there's a lot of extra stuff, which is not necessarily bad because it's Kiss on steroids is what Paul always says. Or it's like Elvis through a Marshall amp and on steroids, right, or something. It seems like that they do that.
And the original ideas they had for the Psycho Circus tour that never made it past one show, that was a Broadway show in itself with the,
right,
you know, the stunt bikers and all that. And I think they were going to have cages with animals and stuff out in the crowd area.
You think that was a Doc McGee idea?
Probably Doc and Gene and Paul. But then they realized the cost and the pain of that.
And everything being in 3D.
I mean,
you think about the liability of something going wrong on the animals or the stunt people.
Right. Well, I mean, the 3D thing, a lot of people considered that a failure on top of everything else anyway. So it was like, you know, it was different. But, you know, I look at it, you know, they played the Nutter Center on that tour. So I don't picture that place ain't big enough to hold all that kind of extra stuff they were going to have, you know, out in the crowd area and whatnot. So they would have had to condense it down for that show.
Well, in several places they played, they were going to have to, I mean, that would have been too big to go into every place that they go. Like you said, because I'm sure the places here in Texas they would have played, it would have had to be cut down. There would have been no way to get all that stuff in there.
Exactly. Now, touching, you mentioned, you know, the Gene thing back in the 80s when he kind of lost interest. Do you think that would have even happened, being that Eric and Tommy were in the band, and if it was all four guys, you know,
well,
harmony
I think it's hard to say because, I mean, you know, they all had their vices, so to speak. And it seems like with Tommy and Eric, they don't really have vices.
Right.
I mean, I don't know their personal life, but you don't hear anything negative about them.
No.
You know, I mean, Tommy plays golf.
Yeah.
I haven't really heard anything else.
Eric collects watches.
Yeah, he collects watches. So, you know, as far as, but Gene and Paul will still be Gene and Paul. So, I don't know. It seems like Gene is more driven to prove himself in every area of life that he possibly can. And if you look at what he's done, I mean, he tries everything. And he doesn't care if it succeeds or not. He just wants to try it. So it's hard to say because if they started in 83 with makeup and they didn't take the makeup off, hypothetically, then he wouldn't have been able to be an actor, or at least be known as, this is Gene Simmons acting in Runaway, because right. he could take the makeup off. So I don't think it would have ever happened. And I mean, I don't know how you'd go about that. You know, it's like, okay, I'm going to be an actor in this movie, but no one knows it's me. Right. Well, then you're not going to get recognition.
Yeah, what's he going to do, run around makeup in the middle? I mean...
Just having some over his face and asking her.
Because I like to think that the reason that it really happened, you know, when it did is, you know, the band, it probably felt like they couldn't keep a solid group of guys together with all the changes at the time, and he probably felt like things were on the verge of, you know, being in danger of, you know, ending, you know,
yeah.
for all else, you know, with the way sales and tours were going.
I think he was unhappy with it, and I think Paul was unhappy with it.
But Paul was, you know, but I think, you know, Eric and Tommy, and if everything was, you know, smooth sailing and, you know, they were all getting along and everything was great, didn't go through member changes, I like to think that he wouldn't have ever done that either.
Right.
They would just kept on rolling. Maybe, you know, some of those 80s era or I guess it'd be 90s era in this scenario would be stronger albums than what they were originally.
Well, as far as like 80s albums, if they started in 70 or it started in 83,
yeah,
with the first album, the 80s albums would have been there, but they would have been wearing makeup, right?
And they would have been like in the 90s too, right? So
about that time, the real 80s albums would have been coming out in the 90s. So right. you would have had like Crazy Nights and Asylum and some of those albums in the 90s, which is like, that sounds like how that's never going to, there's no way that could work.
Right. And I think those would have been different sounding and stronger albums.
It would have been like Carnival of Souls.
There was no,
with Gene's,
I can't imagine them selling records if those 80s records were in the 90s. I don't think they would have sold that many records. I think at that time in the 90s, you got to remember, you know, with the Nirvanas and stuff, people would have not, they're being like, what is this? This is not, you know, I mean, you might still have your core fans, just like any genre of music. You know, there are certain bands that people buy whatever, no matter what era you're in. But I don't know. I just don't think that would have worked very well.
Do you think that there would have been a lot more Kiss albums like Revenge and Carnival of Souls?
Yeah, I think that'd be more the sound they would have gone with, just my opinion. It would have been heavier stuff. I think it would have been.
I've said that about Carnival of Souls, I think, in another podcast, about if they'd have done more promotion on that album, you know, and made a few videos or whatever, I think that album would have took off a lot more. It might not have been the biggest Kiss album, but I think it would have done a lot better.
Right.
There's some good tracks on that. It's just not I go to all the time. That's.
I agree with the sound, though. I think that they would be more labeled as a metal, like an actual metal band. By that point, like the stuff they would be doing, like, you know, not the hardcore thrash and that kind of stuff, but, you know, that sort of like Exodus type stuff, you know, think of, you know, late 80s, early 90s.
Yeah, because type. If Dynasty wouldn't have sounded like Dynasty and they just progressed from the first album, you know, up through, you know, skipping Unmasked, Dynasty, The Elder. Not skipping the albums, but skipping the type of album that they did. Still calling it, you know, Up to Creatures of the Night, then it's like full, the same type of album every time, which is hard to think about because I would love to hear The Elder like that.
Oh, yeah.
I'd love to hear Unmasked and Dynasty like that. I think it'd be great. I'd love to hear that.
Definitely.
I mean, if they're listening.
But, you know, if you think about it, like, in the 90s, like, songs like Tears Are Falling and that kind of stuff, I just don't think that would have worked in all in the 90s. I really don't.
They would have had to really metal it up somehow. Yeah. Which, you know, they're capable of it because Creatures of the Night is a metal album as far as I'm concerned.
Oh, right.
And don't get me wrong, those songs are great. I mean, Asylum, those, I mean, like I've always said, I love those records. But if they were to come out in the 90s and not the 80s, that could have been a... I mean, it had to be heavier. I just think that it was too pop sounding.
So by the time that I'm trying to think here, by the time that that Revenge and Carnival of Souls would have came out, say, from 83 on, well, it would have been almost into the 2000s by then, right?
Right.
And I think that would have been a good fit for that time period, too.
By then, and the reunion would have never happened. There wouldn't be a reunion because it was never, there was no such thing.
Exactly.
Which is strange to even think about.
I think Revenge would have been a good early 2000s, because if you think of that time and where metal was becoming and a lot of that stuff that was out at that time, I think Revenge could have fit in, you know, different sound to it, you know, heavier drums on it and everything.
What's some other bands that was putting out records around that time? Because I, once it gets past certain 90s period, I just draw
a blank. That, like, late 99, 2000, I mean, there were so many, like, you know, Soulfly and Slipknot and, Pantera.
By the time by 2000, you're almost, Pantera's almost about.
Right.
But you had stuff like Damage Plan still coming out and.
Machine Head and, you know, just Machine a lot Head. Of that, like Chimera and just, you know, all kinds of that.
Just heavy, aggressive, not thrash metal necessarily, but on the heavy, almost fast and aggressive. A lot of them had groove stuff to it. Yeah. You know, like Pantera and Soulfly and stuff like that, that was real groove oriented.
A lot of that metalcore stuff. But that's one of my favorite eras of metal. Anyways, like that late 90, early 2000 period, there was just so much cool stuff coming out.
So my question is now, so we're at 2000. We've got
2000, like, man.
So we got like Revenge and that kind of stuff going on.
Uh-huh.
Do you really think they would still have to make, would that record still make the impact with them wearing makeup and those costumes? You see what I'm saying? 'Cause I'm thinking at that point, I can see them in, you know, T-shirts and maybe leather pants, but not the makeup at that point. I mean,
well, if they were wearing costumes and doing albums like Revenge and Carnival of Souls, I would like to think that it's hard to imagine that, but I would think it would just, they'd all be like similar to the first couple. I don't know, maybe Up Through Alive, it'd be sort of like that, but more like a Revenge. If you look at some of the photo sessions they did in Revenge, they were all in black leather.
Well, that's what I'm saying. I can see that, but I'm just not seeing the full Kiss makeup on, is what I'm saying.
Yeah,
it'd be hard to take them serious, I think, in that makeup with those clothes. So.
Right.
I could almost see that they would have decided to take it off at that time just because of the fact that, hey, we don't need it anymore. We're, you know, it is all about the music, and, you know, we're going to kick your ass heavier than what we ever have.
So do you think by doing that, in actuality, what happened in real life, as opposed to the scenario, they would have got more popular, sold more records like they did with Lick It Up originally?
I think so.
Yeah, I agree. I think that, because if you come from the makeup era in this scenario, you hit 2000, they hit you with like Revenge. I mean, it's a heavy album. I just don't see them with the makeup and everything
else. So when would Lick It Up have came out based on this scenario?
That would have been the first album, wouldn't it?
Well, if we're starting with the actual first Kiss album.
Oh, that's right. That's right.
Okay.
So it would be in the 90s. Lick It Up would be in the 90s somewhere.
Yeah.
Like 93? Like
95.
I'd say 92.
Because didn't we say 91 would have been Dynasty?
Yeah. So it'd been later than that. Wouldn't it have been earlier than that, I mean?
It'd have been 95. Would have been Lick It Up.
So that album wouldn't have had the impact that it did in reality.
I don't think so.
Because if they decided to take their makeup off later in their career, which would have been around the same time, you know, as it happened for a different album, then probably Revenge would sell 10 times more than what it sold, or Carnival sold, or whatever album they would have been on at that time. And something else, you wouldn't have had albums like You Wanted the Best, You Got the Best. You probably wouldn't have had a lot of those albums because there wouldn't have been a need for that, because that promoted the reunion tour more or less.
Right.
And then what was after that would have been like Psycho Circus or something, maybe? Or am I jumping, ahead, I think.
I think they threw Carnival out before Psycho Circus, right?
Right.
Yeah.
And then it was Psycho Circus. And
so what was after Psycho Circus? That was 98, so...
was it...
99, 2000.
Was that around the time that they threw out Greatest Kiss? And
probably. I think there was a lot of compilations coming out.
Because then 2000, that was around when the Millennium Concert was supposed to be released.
Right.
As a live four.
And then Symphony came out instead. So, that was, right. Yeah. So, would they have done the Symphony? Because if they're in a position where they've just taken off their makeup and they're wearing, say, leather outfits and stuff, and their music's quite heavy still, I can't see them doing the Symphony.
Well, I disagree. I think you might have seen it because what year was it that Metallica did the Symphony? They did a Symphony.
That's true. I mean, Dimmu Borgir did with a Symphony. Deep Purple's done with a Symphony.
You know, so, yeah. It's kind of a trend there for a little while with some of these heavier bands doing stuff with Symphonies. Yeah. So.
It might not have been an issue.
It's funny you mentioned the Metallica because I just have to mention I listened to that the other night and it's been a while and I got to say how bad I thought that sounds now compared to what I used to think it sounded like.
Really?
It sounds like it's a big clash of the band against the orchestra. Like,
because they're not synced together.
Right,
is that right. Why?
And
because I know Kiss sort of was having that problem if you watched the DVD.
Yeah. And it's just kind of like, I remember thinking like, man, that was a good concept, the video, and I wanted it on black. Now, you know, No Leaf Clover, don't get me, I love that song. That's probably my favorite song off that, you know, because that was really the only way you're going to get it. But, man, I was listening to some of that other stuff, and I'm just like, God, this just does not sound as good as
I'm going to play a little bit. I have to play that again, because I haven't listened to Metallica in a long time. So.
Yeah, it just, I don't know, man. But anyway, just had to throw that in.
But, you know, like I said, I could see Kiss at that time still doing the Symphony thing. I mean, like I said, there was several bands doing it. I don't know how good it sounded at that point. I don't know, but how well it sell, I don't know.
A lot of fans didn't like the Kiss Symphony. I've heard people say that they shouldn't have done it, and it was a mistake. I mean, you can't please everyone. I personally like it just because it's something different.
I love it.
Yeah.
I mean, I like how they did it. I like how they started with just, you know, the straight-up band Kiss concert, then come out and did the little ensemble with a lot of the acoustic stuff, and then did the bomb, you know, the full thing. And, you know, that versus the Metallica one, I take the Kiss one all day long, and it's not because I'm a huge Kiss fan and I'm being biased. I just, the way they mesh that music with the orchestra versus how Metallica did it, it just, it sounds like it goes together so much better.
So if Kiss did Kiss Symphony, you know, in our scenario, it would basically be the same album, more or less.
Right.
Because, and they would be doing probably a different set list. Because they would have different songs that would have been more popular as opposed to the ones that were more popular at the time. And in reality, I mean, I know it's confusing. Right. Anybody out here watching, it's probably confused. Like, what are they talking about? It's hard to follow, understand.
Yeah, you definitely can't take one path on this topic. And I mean, there's just so many scenarios that pop up.
I mean, this could be a two-day conversation straight. Because, you know, you think about it, you know, the what if on that. That's. But, you know, I'm still thinking about when they did start, let's say the 83 thing started. I still think it would be interesting to see the bands that are out now. I mean, they have progressed with them because, you know, like I said, they were such a huge influence. You know, I'm just going back and thinking, what would music be like? Okay, now in present time, 2016, what are some of the bands going to sound like? You know, because they had that influence.
Like, you know, it's like I always say that, you know, every few years, or not so much now, but, you know, there's pivotal bands that come out at least every 10 years or a couple of them, you know. You know, Motley Crue, Guns N' Roses, Metallica, you know, there's different ones that are Nirvana that's changed things, you know, Zeppelin, Sabbath, Kiss. So if Kiss was out at the time when a lot of these 80s bands were out, what 80s band do you think would take what Kiss had done in the 70s originally and took off with it to be an influence? Or do you think that Kiss would have just automatically been an influence at that point? I mean,
that's a good point, because you know, that kind of ties in with, you know, when Gene said rock and roll is dead as we know it. He wasn't meaning literally rock and roll as a whole. He's talking about, like what you said, there's no bands coming out anymore making that sort of impact and becoming the next Nirvana or whoever.
And I can't even name the last band. I mean, really, for me, Nirvana was the last pivotal band.
Right.
And I can't name another band that has come onto the scene like they did, changed the scene, and kept going, you know what I'm saying, and rolled with it, you know?
Yeah. No, because music it seems like music now doesn't have a direction at all.
No.
It's just like, I don't even know how to describe it. It's so... I'm a fan of a lot of the new stuff, you know, but a lot of the new bands that I like sound like old bands.
Right.
That's exactly, yeah.
And a lot of the songs today they're not written with the same heart and meaningful lyrics. They're just words that they come up with or somebody else writes for them. But there just aren't any of those pivotal bands, like you said. And, you know, you got a lot of your flashes in the pan that come along and they get a big following, but they're not doing anything different or changing anything.
Go ahead.
Oh, I was going to say, I can't name any band the last 10 years that I've liked that's still around making music as that band. Now, you know, they may have broken up and other bands have started, but...
Right. Well, see, that's sort of what I was going to say. At first, I sort of thought that the White Stripes was going to be that band.
Yeah.
But they're not even together anymore. And Jack White's done so many other things, you know, solo and with other bands. So they didn't turn out to be that band after all, like I initially thought they would.
A lot of the bands now are just getting where they're at off of the image. And yeah, that's taking a piece out of Kiss's book. But at the same time, the music isn't backing that up and doing, you know, touching people on that level and doing something different. It's really just off the image and that's it. And then they're up there just playing, you know, real basic, you know, AB structure songs, nothing.
Do you think it's the internet?
I think the internet's ruined that a lot with, you know, with the whole iTunes and digital thing and social media. You know, it's ruined so many things as far as, you know, image and, you know, what bands mean. Because, you know, back in the days when the only time you would see a picture of the band you liked was in a magazine. And
exactly. And it's so easy to record music now. I mean, if you have a computer, you can record your music. And, you know, that whole, you know, waiting for a new album from somebody. You know, I just remember, you know, growing up, you hear, like, you've seen the newest metal magazine. Oh, you know, like, the new Guns N' Roses is coming out. You could not wait, but you never had a chance to hear it until it came out, because there was no internet, there was no leaked files or anything. It was just like, and so when you heard it, it was fresh as soon as you heard it, you know. And it just,
yeah.
And the lyrics were good, whether it's Guns N' Roses or whatever. A lot of those lyrics that people wrote, I guess because of my generation or whatever, they sang about something that meant something, you know, whether it was, you know, in the 80s, 70s, whatever, even in the 90s. And now I feel like you said, it's just words. They're not. If you listen to all the lyrics nowadays, you know, because, you know, my wife and son listen to, you know, top 40 radio or whatever. If you really listen to those pop songs, there's rhyming stuff.
Yeah, it's nursery rhymes. That's all it is.
Yeah. And a lot of it's just, if you really listen to it, it's pretty dirty, really, if you think about it, on the radio and the way they're doing stuff. And I'm like, this does not give, you know, when you listen to Kiss or some of the other bands I like, you know, I get chill bumps on my arm. You know, the certain songs will just chill bump me up. And, you know, and I listen to the stuff that my wife does in the car because we're in the car or whatever, some, and I have no chill bumps. Nothing moves me. You know? It's not like, you know, you hear the song, you're like, oh my God, the lyrics are just, you know, amazing, but I don't get that emotional feel, you know?
Right. It's literally nursery rhymes. It's, you know, it's touching with that inner child, you know, so then they come up with, oh, that's a cool rhyme that gets people dancing. And
well, and they make their $1 million and they're gone. That's all they care. You know, they made their money. They're gone, you know, one hit wonders, and it's not a big deal to them, but
they're
the longevity of these bands, it's just not,
They're all fabricated musicians. They're not actual musicians. They're just,
you know, I feel like, and I could be wrong, you guys probably would know this more than I would, but it seems to me like that started, the fabrication started more so, I mean, I know it's always existed in music, but it seemed like it started with rap and hip hop a lot. And it sort of hibernated into regular pop music. You know, it went there because, you know, I think about like Chingy and the Thong Song. Who sung that song?
Cisco.
Yeah, it's like these people are, said, they have one song and they're gone. So it's like hip-hop and rap is where a lot of that, to me, seemed to start.
Well, my argument on that is, though, original hip-hop, I'm a fan of original hip-hop. You know, when you got the early stuff, Run DMC and the stuff earlier than that. So,
right.
So from the 70s coming up, I thought was, again, it was kind of like rock music. A lot of the lyrics had some meaning and stuff to it. You hit the 90s, and you got into the late 80s, you know, got into the gangster rap stuff, which really I had no connection to because I couldn't relate to that.
You're not a gangster.
I'm not a gangster. And then it evolved into, you know, the late 90s, 2000s, where it's just, you know, it's just a bunch of jibber-jabber, and it's just rhyming stuff, and it's not, I mean, they're fine, they can rhyme good, I guess, but it doesn't really, they're not saying anything that means, I mean, maybe it means something to somebody, but to me, right. It's not, you know, I don't have the same connection to that as I do early rap and hip-hop because I grew up listening to that too along with the metal, and I enjoyed that stuff, you know, the beats, the way they mix stuff, and they were actually mixing records.
Yeah, Run DMC.
Digitalized now, you know, you can get two songs and digitalize them on your computer, and you got a rap song going, and it's just not, I mean, I'm sorry if I'm offending somebody who likes that stuff, but
well, I like Run DMC and Beastie Boys and all that stuff.
LL Cool J, all that early death.
I love all that early stuff, like late 70s, early mid 80s, all the way up through that. You know, I even like, you know, Vanilla Ice and Young MC and MC Hammer, all that stuff.
Tribe Called Quest.
Yeah, and even Crisscross and Snow and some of that more obscure.
Arrested Development.
But it just seems like that, you know, a lot of the, that kind of thing, you know, like, and I hate to mention Lady Gaga. But, you know, it's like a lot of those pop bands, they would have like a little rap section in their song. Or they would try to rap, which is even worse. You know, and they got that from the influence of rap and hip-hop. I know we're getting way off the subject here. But it seemed like that it carried over into, you know, culture, more or less. It's just part of culture now.
Rap. Pop culture. Today's rap isn't as good as the old rap, and that's just so weird to say because it's all gone pop. And I still remember a time when hip hop was so, like, you know, it was the bastard child of music, and it got no attention in the media and all over MTV and the music awards were, it wasn't no hip hop. It was more about the rock bands and grunge. Today it's a whole different story.
Well, it's even in commercials. If you look at commercials and movies, everything new, it's that hip-hop, pop hybrid stuff. It's everywhere. I mean, you know, I see kids' movies all the time with my son and everything. And if you listen to it, there's not much rock music in there. And if it is rock, it's converted to a pop, hip-hop sound. It may be, you know, an old song that was originally a rock song, but then they've converted it. And it's so weird to see that. You know, I'm like, oh, you know, he says he likes that song, but I'm like, oh, well, you know, really, you know, Led Zeppelin did that song.
Yeah.
It wasn't a hip-hop pop song, you know, and so.
But I remember a time where people would have that opinion, like, you listen to rap, huh? You must be some kind of thug or blah, blah. And, you know, and now you got the award shows are nothing but hip-hop. There's not a mention of rock or metal on there. And you got all this. The society loves it now. You get middle-aged people dancing to it and all.
Yeah, you got these, you know, middle-aged housewives. That are, you know, listen to this.
Like on
I don't even know what the new artists are, but, you know, those really cool
like on the Ellen show, like, they're all dancing to this shit. And it's like, I remember 10, 15, 20 years ago when they wouldn't be caught dead.
Well, you know, that's really, it's confusing to me because, like, with the award shows and stuff, you know, they have hip-hop artists that will be there on that show that year, and next year will be a whole different crop of the same type of artist, you know, because they come and go, like Chad said.
Yeah.
But then also, as far as, like, you know, us being record collectors, what people want most of is metal. That's what most people collect, is metal, rock and metal. So that's like, there's like these two separate things that exist at the same time and have nothing to do with each other. And it's hard to believe that it can be so popular that the award shows and TV and everything is just saturated with all that hybrid stuff. And then there's all these metal and rock people out here that like, that's what the music, that's, and I hate to say it like that because it makes me feel old, but it's like all the good music has already been made.
Right.
Yeah.
And, you know, the society today, and especially MTV and all that, you know, Lady Gaga, Beyonce, and some of these other, Rihanna, whoever, it's like they're trying to portray like they're these legends already. Like they've already, like they're right. compared to Aretha Franklin or Diana Ross, you know, some of them real legendary stars, and they try to act like, and I'm not buying it. It just pisses me off. I mean, you know, it's at the point.
And they're wearing Metallica shirts in the
closet. That's what I was going to say. I'm like, but they're not, the shirts they're wearing, if you look at that, if you see some of the articles, they're like some kind of redo or whatever. They're like $200 t-shirts or whatever. But they look like they're faded and they're, you know, like they're a vintage shirt. They're not vintage shirts. They're just shirts that have been modified and they're paying $200 for it. Or they're putting sequences on them and stuff. Yeah, I'm not sure with sequences. That's just a bunch of crap. I'm like,
Then you'd start seeing a bunch of them doing this.
Right.
And that's what really started pissing me off.
You had Justin Bieber doing this, and I'm like, really, dude? I was like, that's...
Like, you'd see, like, on a, say, like, a show, there'd be, like, I don't know, like, some band, like, I don't know, Fall Out Boy, as an example, playing, and you see people out in the crowd. It's like, really, dude? Like, you don't even know what that's supposed to be used for and what it means. It's like,
that's turned into the universal symbol for everything.
That's sad. We're at this point. And because, again, that's, you're the devil if you're listening to that. Well, but now you got...
As we're having this conversation, I'm realizing how old I am.
Same here.
There is some new bands, especially metal bands, that they're good. But I find the bands I listen to, the newer bands I listen to, especially like, cause I listen to a lot of Stoner and Doom and that kind of stuff. They're all influenced by Black Sabbath and that kind of stuff. So really, it's new versions of Sabbath, but they still got that old sound. I guess it's because it's still got the old sound to it. I mean, they're new, but they're still playing the old stuff, or a version of it, you know. Yeah. And so.
We all, you know, we all sound like old farts on here, kids these days, and blah, blah. But it's how it is, and that's the way I view it. You know, it's at the point now where I've recently thought about, you know, getting rid of almost all of my hip hop albums because I'm just like, I'm kind of just losing that taste, you know, for that stuff. And you know, there's certain things I'll hang on to, but
it's not because we're old. It's the music is just like. There's no music. And it's like Chad said, I mean, I like everything. You've seen, you know, some of the records that I buy.
Behind you and see that.
I like everything. So, you know, I don't want to incriminate myself. I don't know why that worries me, but, you know, I'll listen to anything once. Mm-hmm. And if I like it, I like it. If I don't, I usually don't listen to it anymore, which is very rare with me because, you know, my tastes are so wide variety of stuff. But as far as what you guys were saying about, you know, I'll just use One Direction, and then they're not a band anymore. But, you know, they've had songs written for them.
Yes.
For 3 out of the 4 albums or something. And the last album they did before they went on hiatus, they wrote the majority of their songs. And I don't like the album. You know, it's just not good because, and I'm not saying it's because they've written the songs, although I know that is a fact. So, you know, what is it?
See, that's what you have the right to have that opinion because you listened to it. You gave it a chance. Mm-hmm. So many people, like even with Kiss, you know, they don't give them a chance to even try to listen. They're just, oh, they suck. Oh, right. Screw that. you know, at least you give them a chance to listen. You know, am I going to give that a chance? No, but that's me. That's, you could tolerate things more than I can.
I don't expect everyone to sit down and listen to every Kiss album. No. You know, before they can have, and that's a lot of albums, before they can have an opinion, you know. But I think that, you know, with, and Kiss being the example, you know, same stuff that's played on radio all the time, you know, Rock and Roll Night, Beth, Detroit Rock City, and that's all people are basing it on. It's like, right. You realize they've been making records for 40 plus years, and you realize that those three or four songs aren't on every album.
And those aren't even necessarily the best songs on the album.
Right. And so, you know, people that do say, oh, they suck, they're basing it on the visual once again.
All right. So that's, I think we're going to kind of wrap up on that subject. You know, we can go on and on all night about this, but, you know, maybe we could touch on it again down the road at some point and discuss it more. So I think we'll start wrapping this episode up. We'll get into the trivia here and call it an episode. And we're going to go back to the original way, of course. I believe it's me and Brenton.
Yes, it is. Left off. Okay. So. All right. As usual, we'll go to five. Yep. So first one to five. Name the month and year that Dynasty was released. The month and the year.
79. That's all I can give.
March 79.
Close.
April 79.
Not yet. Come on, Brent, jump in here.
February 79.
What'd you say, Brent?
October.
No.
May.
There you go. May 1979.
Wow.
Jeez.
Knew that off the top of my head. Easy one.
Next question. Kiss cut Dressed to Kill at what studio?
Electric Lady.
Yep.
I just didn't know that.
Abbey Road.
There you go.
Close.
Say it like Paul Stanley does on his stage raps.
Okay, let's see.
You're not going to do it, are you?
No, I'm not that good.
Nice.
On Peter Criss's solo album, where does it go? What is the second song on the album?
Second song.
You Matter
second
to Me.
Second song. What did you say?
You Matter to Me.
Both said it same time.
Yeah, I give you each credit for that one.
That's crazy that we know that.
That was weird.
And it's Peter Criss's solo album, of all things.
Yeah, the one what's nobody the third, really likes.
What's the third song? Is it Tossin' and Turnin'?
That's right.
I think it. No.
Is it?
Yeah, it's Tossin' and Turnin'. First song is I'm Gonna Love You. Next one is You Matter to Me. Then Tossin' and Turnin'.
Oh, okay.
Wow. And then Hooked on Rock and Roll?
Nope, it was Don't You Let Me Down.
Oh, okay.
That's Hooked kind of Sugar Papa likes.
Yep. The Easy Thing.
And then Rock and Roll All Night.
All right, staying on that same thing, on Gene Simmons' solo album, what is the opening track?
Radioactive.
Okay.
I thought it was called Hosanna, Hosanna.
Well, that was a different solo album.
What is that from, anyway? Is that like from The Exorcist or something that he's trying to emulate? Because I always wondered about that intro.
You know, I've never heard him talk about it or nothing.
It sounds familiar. It's almost like it's something I've heard before, you know, like out of a movie or some, I don't know. I always wondered about that. That'd be a good question to ask GeneSimmons.com.
That's what I was going to say. Next time you see him, you need to ask Gene that.
Yeah.
It almost sounds like there's some stuff that's backwards in that that he's saying. So
yeah, almost,
I've never.
Now I want to listen to it.
What year did they release MTV Unplugged Kiss?
95.
No.
96.
96. That's it.
What? Beans and pickles.
All right. Eli needs one more. Brent needs three more.
Okay. Great.
At least I can find a branding question.
How about if I ask myself a question?
Okay, go for it. Let's see what happens. See if you can get it before Eli does.
What color is Sergeant Green's blue horse?
Come on, Eli.
Who's Sergeant Green?
You're asking me?
It's yellow.
Absolutely. You win.
All right, this is going to be a year one. Let's see. Okay, everybody's favorite album, Smashes, Thrashes, and Hits, was released what year?
88.
Eli won that one. Sorry, Brenton. You should have known that one. You know,
Drash.
Jeez. Drash. All right, this round, it's all Eli.
God damn it.
Dang. Well, that's it on the trivia for this week.
That seemed to go a lot quicker than it usually does.
Yeah. Oh, Eli's answering all the questions.
So, right. I have one last question.
Okay.
Would, in our scenario, would Kiss be doing the Freedom's Rock Tour?
Yes.
I agree. I think so.
It's possible.
Because I know Gene's always been supportive of the troops. I think he's kind of the one that pushed that. And, you know, he would have still come from the same background. So I think eventually, yeah.
Because I know they've got progressively more patriotic as they went along. And I don't know if there's a reason for that. I'm not saying there has to be a reason.
I don't know if this year was kind of designed because there happened to be an election or...
Right.
I don't know. I mean, maybe it's just their way of, you know, really giving back to the troops again. I mean, they've done things before, but...
The ice bucket challenge was great.
Yes. Well, then the one tour, they were given $1 from every ticket sold.
Uh-huh.
The Wounded Warrior. I remember hearing something about that.
And this time, though, it's more of a, you know, a bigger spectrum. So, I mean, I'm not sure the reason behind it, but, I mean, I kind of don't see why there needs to be one at the same time. But,
yeah.
You know, not to.
I think they're doing a good thing. So.
Yeah.
Yeah.
So, all right, everybody. So we're gonna wrap this. We're gonna wrap this episode up before we go all night chatting about this stuff. But
we rock and roll all night
and party every day.
Before we wrap up, real quick, I just want to remind everybody we do all have lots of stickers, and I still have two more envelopes. It's got some stickers and some other goodies in it. So if you want one of these, I got like two left. Message me or message whoever. Let me know your address and I will send you one. And or some stickers if you just want stickers. And I think Eli and Brighton still has some stickers to give away.
So. Yep. I still got all of mine. And so hit us up for that. Stickers. You know, hit the like button on this video on YouTube. You know,
check and us also, out. The people I've been giving stickers to, I've been giving everybody that wants one, two stickers. You can keep one, do whatever you want with it. Take the other one, and I've had people putting it in public places. So, whether it be a bathroom or a club you go to or whatever, There's actually some friends here in town that I gave them to, and they're actually at some local restaurants. There's a couple of poles by the restaurant.
Upside down, man.
They have some stickers on them, and our sticker is in the middle of all those. So
nice.
Anyway, so if you get some stickers, please hang them up somewhere. Get us a promotion. Get you as many stickers as you want. So as long as you hang them out and promote us, that'd be great. So
nice.
And thank you for everybody who has hung stickers up and, you know, wanted some. So
yeah,
more merchandise is coming soon. I'm working on some stuff right now. Hopefully by Christmas we'll have some other cool goodies to give away. So
yep. So
and subscribe to our channel.
Yes, please.
We noticed we had some subscribers, and check our Facebook page out.
Facebook, check us out on SoundCloud. Please share, follow us on there. Hit the like button on this video on YouTube. That helps out. Please spread
leave
the word.
Leave us some comments.
Yes, and yeah. Leave your comments. Let us know what you think. What are some of your thoughts on how you think things would have turned out had KISS started in 83 instead of 73. So, all right, everyone. Until next week, we are out of here. See you later.
See ya. Anyway, Brent, you're not the only one that has a man bag. I carry a man bag also everywhere I go. And I have a Gene and Paul button on there. I had Ace and Peter, but they literally fell off somewhere. And I don't know where they are. I think one of them is in San Antonio, and I'm not sure where the other one is. So
anyway. So even in button form, they both left the band.
They both left the band. So.
What the hell?
Damn their luck.